Storytelling is an art that I truly can't thank enough. In short, everything that I absolutely love, whether we're talking about comic books, TV shows, movies, anything really, has been based on how well structured the story is. Why do I care? What themes are being presented? Who do I relate to? Questions I often ask myself beforehand, and if the story's being told right, they get answered very swiftly. One of my favorite TED Talks to revisit is Andrew Stanton's Clues to a Great Story, a practical roadmap to creating an engaging, endearing, exciting, relatable story that even if the subject matter is fiction or, for lack of better terms, unrelatable, the point and overarching theme translates to a universal audience, as the struggles and triumphs, though very different, are very similar at the end of the day. Andrew's whole point is that if you use these tools to your advantage, your story will translate no matter the subject matter. A point that proved itself true as I, a kid in 2014, coming from a solid suburban county and safe upbringing, found myself immersed in a true story of gang violence, addiction, and loss of faith. Immersed in a story about a Hoover Crip willing to do anything to make sure his daughter is fed and living a better life than he has as a kid. A story that goes by the title Oxymoron. Schoolboy Q has been my favorite rapper for years now, and though I was a fan years prior, the release of Oxymoron solidified him in my top 5 forever. In a time before being able to afford streaming services, I was normally getting my music through illegal MP3 download sites, but being that Q was one of my favorites, I went to my local Target and copped my first CD ever. Not even 10 minutes later from getting home from the store, I popped it in, and I've never had an album grip me quite like this one had. Very intently listening to the stories of Q struggling with his addiction to various drugs, the early stages of his life that led him to becoming a Hoover Crip, and his ongoing struggles with praying to escape a life of violence, selling drugs, and gangbanging, but doing exactly that to make sure that his daughter's mouth was fed. To say that Q was being vulnerable is a gross understatement, and that vulnerability showcased how great of an MC and songwriter he is. Talent that's showcased on the entire album. But to give a taste of what makes this so special, we're gonna break down these 4 songs: Gangsta, Hoover Street, Prescription Oxymoron, and Blind Threats. With a title like Oxymoron, it might make first-time listeners ponder on what the connection is to Q. And he explains the oxymoron in this album is that I'm doing all this bad to do good for my daughter. That's why I'm robbing, that's why I'm stealing. Whatever it is that I'm talking about in my album that's negative, it's always for a good cause, for my daughter. And he proved that in his raps, yes, but he took an even further step and put her on wax.
Hello? Hello? Fat rap. My daddy a gangster.
Nigga, I made it when I was broke, I got me that 9. Yeah. With that 9, I hit me that lick, and then with that lick, it came with that Yola. Yeah. With that Yola, it came with your bitch, and see now your bitch, you gon' work on that corner. Yeah. I don't care if that hoe got pneumonia. Yeah. Give me racks and you won't get a quota. Yeah. She don't run game, I'm the only controller. So what's up now, straight pimpin' over here, and I put that shit on verbs, nigga. Have her shaking ass all on the curb, nigga. You can tell that she fucking with a fig, nigga.
And probably one of his most cutthroat songs ever, Q starts the album with his daughter proclaiming before this rap shit, Q was living a very different life, the life of a gangster, a life that has levels to it, and unfortunately one thing always leads to another. Financial trouble means getting a gun, and with that gun getting money got a lot easier, meaning the greed for more money goes up and drug selling comes into play. With one thing leading to another, the confidence in Q grows as he's no longer a broke kid trying to find his way with a gun, but now a full-on pimp with nothing to worry about, so he thinks, fully immersed in this lifestyle.
Grandma showed me my first strap, my nigga Raton always had the flyest gats, I finally got mine. Dirt nap, real niggas don't die, homeboy, we multiply and shit. Come around my town, you clown, that's suicide and gangsta.
I've always loved this portion of this song for the simple fact that it feels so genuine. A kid finding a gun in their parent or grandparents' rumored closet is the start to a lot of people's story, and Q has gone on record about how important it was that he put that detail into the intro of his album. Going into the second verse, Q details the lectures he'd get from his mom to not become a product of his environment. But little did she know, due to her work schedule, Q was already becoming that. A dope selling, gun-toting gangster from Hoover Street. After giving a glimpse into how this lifestyle began for him in gangster, he takes it a step further in Hoover Street, taking us on a detailed journey through his youth, detailing the various things he experienced, witnessed, and observed in the neighborhood and in its own household. I done jumped up off my ass, hit the lick and barely passed, but I quickly got the ball in. 2012, it really happened, so I guess it's back to trapping. Eyes open night to morning. Had roaches in my cereal, my uncle stole my cereal, my grandma can't control it. Every last one of us had a pistol in the room, nigga. This currently and probably always will stand as one of my favorite Q choruses, purely based on the fact that it's as catchy as it is, but also the purpose it serves, serving as a precursor to the stories of Q's uncle being a very rough influence on him at an early age, showcasing that when addiction's at its peak, the subject of said addiction will do quite literally anything to get the money for their fix. A reality Q knows all too well. Grandma said she loved me, I told her I loved her more. She always got me things that we couldn't afford. The new J's and Tommy Hill in my drawers. Sega Genesis, Nintendo 64. Cigar and I was way of war. We wasn't thinking getting money then. Nor did I wonder why my uncle done sold his Benz. Cause he been tripping now, he sweats a lot and slimming down. I also noticed moms be locking doors when he around. But anyways, his wife done left him, now he living with us. My bike is missing, grandma liked to hide a check every month. My uncle's nuts, he used to give me whiskey to piss in cups. Knocking on the door, telling me to hurry up, he in a rush. I gave it to him, then got my ass whipped for doing it. Moms used to tell me, like, nigga, know who you dealing with. Them was the good days, till I raised the older ways. Ratone, my nigga's brother, showed me my first K. I was amazed, me and Floyd was in the back, he called us over like, hey. Yak, 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 we like, damn, nigga. Then again, yak, yak, we like, damn, nigga. Hearing them say cuz turned us to a fan, nigga. Later on, he got locked, so now we taking his phase. Continued the chapter from his life, we flipping that page. Gangbanger was a ritual, and grandma would help. She should have never left her gun on the shelf. Q begins to tell the story of his loving grandma and how she was willing to do anything for her loved ones, making financial sacrifices to provide Q with the flyest clothes and video games that he wanted, a similar love that she had for her own child and Q's uncle, who after a divorce from his wife moved into their house. Q as a kid is slowly picking up on why she did leave him, noticing locked doors to bedrooms when he's home, and his physical condition being at an extreme low due to his drug use and increasing need for said drugs. An increasing need that makes it easy for him to sell his car or steal from his loved ones. Q getting a front row seat for most of his uncle's life as a gangster and or addict led him in a similar direction, as he then details the start of his life on the streets by explaining the first time he rode along for his first drive-by and was instantly hooked on becoming a Hoover Crip. It was solidified he wanted to live that way on that day, but he makes a callback to the intro track Gangster, saying it really started with his grandma's gun on the shelf. Q in more ways than not was becoming a mirror image of his uncle, and not only becoming a gangster, but also an addict. Up to this point in the record, Q had been dropping hints of regular drug use, but a full deep dive on his heavy usage would come to light on part one of the two-song track, Prescription Oxymoron. The transparency displayed on the song is what makes it one of Q's best. Tale of the drug dealer becoming reliant on the drugs in more ways than just finances. Prescription drugs, show me love, Percocets, Adderall, Zanny balls, get codeine involved, stuck in his body high, can't shake it off, I'm falling off, I can't hold a thought, what's wrong with me, now depression creep, I'm stressing deep, even in my sleep. My mommy calls, I hit ignore. My daughter calls, I press ignore. My chin press on my chest, my knees press the floor. I'm blanking out, woke up on the couch. Dinner on my shirt, I'm coming curse. I had a boss selling 80s, but yo, the karma's worse. I cry when nothing's wrong, I'm mad when peace alone. My senses harm, sluggish, ruggish. A couple Xannies pop, open my pill box. Prescription drug. and possibly one of his most descriptive verses to date, Q details the pain and darkness that he's feeling when taking these variety of drugs, listing out perks, Adderall, Xans, and lean as his drugs of choice. He starts the verse asking these drugs to show him love, as he's just looking for the next thing to help him cope with the lifestyle he's chosen over the years. The deep dive goes deeper as he begins to talk about how his mental health along with his physical health has taken a turn that leaves him crying when nothing sad is seemingly happening, and has him questioning himself, asking what's wrong. He's become a shell of himself that has become very reliant on these drugs, and it's to a point where it's scary. Hearing this song for the first time paired with the interviews he was doing for press at the time had me genuinely worried as a fan. A fear that peaked when he sat down with Angie Martinez and she shared similar fears with him in person.
I'm a little worried, I'm gonna be honest. You're making me concerned a little bit.
About me?
Yeah, I feel like you like it too much. I feel like it's a little, it's got a whole.
Nah, I just told you, I quit it for my whole album. I haven't been on lean for a whole month straight yet. I haven't been on lean for a whole
month straight. You just told me you've been.
Since I stopped,
since I stopped,
then I came back. I don't even got a cup now.
But you want one?
Of course.
I'm thinking, that's what I'm saying.
I'm looking at her soda like that motherfucker was a Sprite. But it's cool, though.
So I shouldn't be worried.
I'm not thirsty. Like, I ain't burnt out.
All right.
These fears translate very clear with Q's daughter being featured on this song, asking her comatose father to wake up.
Daddy.
Q has gone on record saying that this record has no rules, and that putting his daughter on this song in this fashion is proof of it, saying, "You can't expose me. I done already exposed myself. I done put my daughter on the song where I'm in a coma. Can't they take your kids for that? I done took it way too far if that's the case." He's shown signs of regret in interviews, but the story was his story, and he felt it needed to be told in the rawest fashion possible. In the second verse, as opposed to asking for love, he proclaims he's fallen in love with prescription drugs, personifying these drugs as a girl he's head over heels for, and when she's gone, he can't handle the feeling. Q is an exemplary storyteller, and this song itself really hones in on the concept of oxymoron. The oxymoron being the drugs he's become so dependent on were the same drugs he was dealing to make sure his daughter was straight. The second portion of the two-part song details the life of the seller, featuring the catchy hook that cleverly explains Q's switch from selling crack to oxy poo. Q in his early years, and still to this day, has had a very West Coast cutthroat way of explaining what was really going down in this lifestyle he chose, and his verses here are just a glaring example of him being willing to tell this story as honestly as possible, with no details missed.
Stop selling crack today. When it get hot, smoke a pill, watch you glide like Dr. J. I prescribe you when you're Dr. K. You can crush this shit, you can sniff this shit, you can take this shit, you can smoke this shit. Do you like this shit, nigga? Yeah. Your brain go numb, synthetic heroin. Without the injections, got the same love and affection. How could they say feeling good is an addiction? But the world is full of shit, so I don't listen. In fact, we live in a die as a contradiction.
The two perspectives of the seller and the user often bleed into each other as you hear him really pitch drugs to a potential buyer, but he's simultaneously selling himself on doing these drugs and asking the question angrily, how could they say feeling good is an addiction? A question I'm sure most, if not all, addicts really deep in it have asked those trying to help. When it comes down to it, these songs encapsulate the entire point of this record. All this bad was really for the good of his daughter, but the bad is overflowing and starting to negatively affect his and her life, leaving him to pray to God for a way out. But the prayers that while living this lifestyle seem to be left unanswered, leaving him continuing to pray, but in the same breath living the violent lifestyle that has provided him the most. After being incredibly transparent about the cons of being both a drug user and seller, Q takes an introspective look into the day-to-day struggles of being a gang member, going toe-to-toe with possible death, committing sins, and questioning if the God he prays to is even real.
Dreaming, I don't live up on the block no more. Trapping, trying to make it out this obstacle. Life on the edge, hell a block away. Pretty Snow White turn 8 today. Selling that bass, no Dr. Dre. Guess who in the building? Bucket hat with a strap like a pilgrim. Kneeling down with some questions to address, like why the ones commit the worst sins, live the best. The Ten Commandments, I can mark 5 checks, but I sense flaws. The Bible preaching blind threats. Street tell me down, got faith in a Pyrex. Faith in a 4-5, I call it the clarinet. Sewer full of drugs when the toilet digests from the cop raid. All can relate from the streets to the wall, from niggas to compadres. When the sun go down, I'm predicting a heat wave. Forecast your whole body, he all room for the homies. I just pray that the Lord got me. But if God don't help me, this gun will. I swear I'm gonna find my way.
Here Q is being extremely vulnerable about how with ease he can mark 5 checks off the Ten Commandments list, but yet he's still living a life where money comes easy for him and life is decent, leading him to question if these commandments and the word throughout the Bible is just a lie altogether. He deep down doesn't believe that because after a day slash night of doing the dirt, he still finds himself praying to the same God he questions.
Let's shoot that pledge allegiance. Kill mine, kill yours, make it even. Soul needs saving, Mr. Preacher. I know I only come around when it's Easter. Funerals, Thanksgiving, Christmas time. When I'm in jail or when my car decline. Will you answer me? Take me out of hell and make plans for me. Misery loves company, ain't a surprise. It was just me and my niggas, we was trying to survive. But we would never make it out alive. Should we live and die? Oxymoron. Hope to get to heaven till that day arrive. Running through the alley, hope the bullet don't collide. Car window shattered, glass on my right side. Dogs bark in the backyard, room for me. Out of shape belly, courtesy of 40. Spoiled, only child, baby boy Jody. Same jacket on from back in the day. Praying that the Lord come and take me away.
If it hasn't become clear, each song on the album, for the most part, presents an oxymoron. This specific oxymoron cuts deep as Cube is pleading for his life outside of gangbanging, something that inevitably will catch up and incarcerate or even worse, kill him. Saying it best with the line, "We're living to die," oxymoron. Schoolboy Q, though doing the worst things he could have possibly done in his life for his daughter, saw the light at the end of the tunnel and was able to make a career out of telling these stories and was able to provide a better life for not only himself, but arguably more importantly, his daughter. Like I stated in the beginning of this video, Q is solidified as one of my favorite MCs because of this record. His effortless storytelling, though a story that I cannot fully relate to, is easily translatable as it's truly an explanation of being willing to do anything for a loved one, even if it means being a personified version of an oxymoron.